Welcome, welcome, welcome to unfamiliar territory. Probably not some voices you're used to hearing.
This is the second voice
that you're not used to hearing. Well, this is our takeover. This is our big chance. Oh, I'm just getting comfortable for this one. We are, as it says on these mugs that we got for Christmas, we are Thank You for the Podcast. We're a My Chemical Romance podcast, but today, maybe by surprise, I'm not really sure what the marketing around this episode is going to be like. we're taking over the Zeitgeist collection.
Lab
collection.
What does Zeitgeist mean?
Oh, you asked me this like earlier and I think I just ignored you.
I said I was going to Google it on pod for a bit.
Oh, okay. Fuck. Is this part of the bit?
Me telling you that it's a bit is not part of the bit.
Oh, fuck, man. I didn't know how meta we were going.
You fucked up a bit. But I also did forget to have my phone out so that I could Google it. Let's Google it.
I think Zeitgeist means like just kind of like what's in the air of pop culture, kind of. Or
the defining spirit or mood of a particular period of history.
Okay.
As shown by the ideas and beliefs of the time.
Oh, okay. Yeah, okay. That makes sense then.
So it just basically means the vibe.
Yeah, what vibes are going around at the time. We got vibes all the time.
Sorry. Just
do a little quick adjust on myself.
We got a whole new setup.
Yeah, we're changing setups every week.
Yeah, we're testing it out on this one instead of our own, but...
Yeah, why not?
We have a bookshelf now. That's pretty sick.
Yeah, it's a cool life update.
The setup. We got these mugs that say our podcast name on them.
And one single Christmas ornament.
Yeah.
So once again,
and a new chair. New chair, new lamp, yeah, speakers. We got a new setup with the sound, so it might not sound like shit.
Yeah, this is going to sound super professional. If you're coming from our podcast
if you know anything about us, we sound like shit. So this one might not sound like shit.
Yeah, now we got all sorts of direct audio. You guys are going to be hearing the videos and such that we listen to exactly as we hear them, assuming you put on the same headphones that we're wearing.
Yeah, we got...
We'll link our specs in the description.
We got some Audio Technica brand something or others.
Yeah, just go out and buy something that sounds that
one
like
of them
that
has and, the number 30 and one of them has the number 40.
That'll get That's you somewhere. That'll get you somewhere. Yeah, so put on those exact headphones, sink into your chair, light up a fat one, or if you're not into that, do a line of cocaine instead.
Open up the YouTube app on your 2013 Acer computer, Chromebook OS no longer supported, and
go into the smallest room in your house.
Yeah,
and then you'll be in our shoes.
Yeah, perfect.
But we're here. We shouldn't fuck around too much on
enough
someone else's
us.
Podcast. Yeah, enough of. Oh, follow us too. Follow us at Thanks for the Pod. No vowels in any of those words except for the word pod.
They'll link it, I'm sure.
Yeah, there'll be links. If you can't find those links, then you're very lazy, in my opinion. It's not hard. So we're here. We're here today, this week, because their show is weekly, I think. I think Zeitgeist is weekly.
Whatever,
we just kind of post whenever. We just kind of go with the flow. The vibe. Vibes. That's what I'm saying. Our show is all about vibes. This show is about one thing and one thing in particular right now. It's about drive-thru records bands and... This week, we've been assigned the task of covering the band Steel Train.
A grueling one.
Yeah. This band, Steel Train, they were signed to Drive-Thru Records at some point in time, probably in the mid-2000s, from what I can tell. They're an indie band from New Jersey. And how would you describe their sound, Frank? How would you describe the sound of the band Steel Train from what we've heard together? Oh, particularly, before you go, we're covering the record Trampoline in particular, but we'll probably talk about some other stuff.
I mean, it sounds like fun. I don't know what, yeah.
So, who's in this band that's significant
to
you?
The lead singer there, the only one actually pictured in this photo that is captioned Steel Train is Jack Antonoff. None of the rest of the band is there in this photo that is credited to be
which
the
is
band.
Funny because like they've had a few members, but like I've seen a pretty consistent lineup of a couple of these guys at least. Like it seems like there were at least some pretty consistent members in the band for its duration between. From what I'm seeing is like 2002 to 2013, maybe. When did they actually form? Yeah, okay, that was accurate.
Oh, Jack Antonoff is in Fun, if you don't know.
Yeah,
I didn't say that.
Yeah, he was one of the three main members of the band Fun who actually did the, you know, who were credited
as
being members of the band.
Also the band Bleachers.
Yeah.
Now.
Yeah, Bleachers.
If you're familiar
well.
With
Bleachers
that,
pretty cool.
They slap.
Yeah, he's the main guy here in Steel Train. He seems to be the mastermind behind it all. And yeah, I think as a result, you do get a lot of songs, at least on this record, that are very reminiscent of Fun. There are many times I was listening to this record and thinking to myself, man, if Nate Roos was here, this would just be a Fun song. And we'll get around to that, actually. We'll talk about Nate Roos again later, believe it or not. I have a surprise for everyone.
I think it would be probably better if he was there.
Yeah, I mean, then it would just be Fun, and then they would have won several Grammys.
Yeah,
at
fucking
least two.
Eat shit, Jack Antonoff. Did he win any Grammys?
Well, if he was in Fun, then he probably won the, you know what I mean? He probably also won those Grammys. All right,
whatever. That's
valid. But I'm saying he would have had more Grammys had he gotten hold. Well, I'll get to what I'm trying to say here soon. I don't want to ruin too many surprises, but just on this Wikipedia page here, it says they've toured with the Juliana Theory, Tegan and Sarah, Girl in a Coma, Ben Folds, The Fray, Silver Sun Pickups, Hanson, The Format, Gomez, I'm skipping around, Bare Naked Ladies, and Fun, actually. They did eventually tour with Fun. So that means Jackie here was he's pulling double duties on those tours.
Yeah.
He had to play guitar
seven
twice.
Of those bands.
Yeah. They played their final show at the Bowery Ballroom in January of 2013. Maybe a year after I graduated high school or so. The following year.
Do you think that this band breaking up caused MCR to break up too? You think they were so sad they were like, oh, I can't believe Steel Train isn't around anymore.
Was it around the same time?
Well, it says that they broke up in January 2013.
Was that the same month?
No, MCR broke up in March.
Wow. I mean,
literally 2 months later, they were like, I can't continue.
You know, that's probably the reason My Chemical Romance broke up. I think if we were to sit Gerard down today, right now, on this podcast and say, hey, Gerard, I know it's been a minute, but like, just be honest, man. Like, why did MCR break up? Like, if you had to really break it down for us, I think he'd just say, well, this band Steel Train broke up, and we were all so downtrodden about it that instead of killing ourselves, we just broke up the band.
Yeah. That's probably exactly what happened.
And thank God they did, because I was going to say now they're back, but not real. Yeah. Listen to our podcast. That's kind of a running joke at this point, huh? They're not really back, but
yeah.
Maybe COVID is a lie, and it's just a way to cover up MCR not really being back because they didn't know how to.
It's the 1 year anniversary of them, quote unquote, being back.
Yeah, yeah.
And what do we have to show for it? Absolutely fucking nothing.
I've heard a lot of theories as to why COVID is a lie, and none of them really make sense to me. This is the first time it's ever kind of, you know, really clicked.
All right, let's stop talking about MCR.
Do you think that Steel Train is named after a train that carries steel?
I was thinking more that it was a train made out of steel.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of the steel train, it's a steel train.
Yeah.
Wow.
You
think an indie rock band? Yeah, maybe. A train made out of steel. Do you think? Well, I mean, I guess a lot of trains are made out of steel, right?
Yeah, probably.
So it's just a train.
Yeah.
Was Train a band yet? They could have just called their band Train.
They had to have been.
In 2002, maybe not.
Let me get my Google machine.
Yeah,
out.
Why don't you tell me when the band Train, who wrote such hit songs as Hey Soul Sister and Drops of Jupiter, tell me when they formed. I would love to know. I think our audience would love to know, too. Oh, but yeah, sorry. While Frank Googles that.
Oh, damn.
Oh, what's up?
They formed in 1993.
Oh, that explains why they're so good. They've had a long time to get really like good at practicing their instruments.
Hey, Lana Lila.
But yeah, that's Steel Train's other members. The only guy who like has a Wikipedia page other than Jack Antonoff, just He did something for like The Lion King on Broadway, I think.
Yeah,
I think he played Simba, but that was before he did this.
Sick.
Yeah, it was before he did this though, so who fucking cares? But they released three studio albums. The self-titled one was their last one. I have Jack.
Damn, they only did three albums in
Fun only did
11
two.
Years.
Oh, in 11 years though, 11 yeah.
11 years.
Yeah, that's a long time to only do three albums. I mean, they did a lot of silly covers.
They had a bunch of other shit to do.
Yeah.
They were in like a million other bands, but.
Yeah, it feels like just a lot of like studio guys almost, just like jamming it out. Yeah. Like all they're doing is music, which, hey, that's cool.
Should we get into Jack Antonoff?
I brought his Wikipedia page up. Sorry, I'm
okay.
Trying to see if anything about Jack Antonoff is interesting. Not really. I mean, he went to fucking school. He went to.
Wait, were those associated acts or okay? Good. I was afraid that he had like written music for
Grimes.
Yes, specifically.
Maybe. I mean, maybe he did. I don't know. Yeah, he's a real fueled by ramen kind of guy.
Is he still married to what's her tits?
Let me take a look.
It doesn't say spouse. It
doesn't, but maybe Taylor Swift. He co-wrote Sweeter Than Fiction.
I'm not familiar.
It's all right. I'm not either. I don't know.
What
maybe
does it say?
If it does, wait, it's. Wait. Here we go.
Yeah.
Lena Dunham is dating at the time. Resides with Sherwood Dunham, where he owns. Oh no, maybe they're not. Relationship with Scarlett Johansson. God, his personal life is complicated.
Okay, so he's no longer with Lena Dunham.
Yeah, okay. Well, that's
good.
Better.
We here don't like Lena Dunham.
Yeah, Lena Dunham's a real shitter.
Yeah.
For several reasons. But man, enough about indie pop sensation Jack Antonoff. He's off doing his own thing nowadays.
If you're not familiar with Bleachers, they got a couple bangers.
Yeah, you know.
But
maybe he's better off. I don't know.
But this album, Trampoline, my biggest issue with it, honestly, is that the photo on the cover here is of a Ferris wheel, not a trampoline.
Yeah, do you think that's on purpose? Or do you think that's like maybe
I think it's just an artsy picture they took.
Yeah, but like why would
they found?
Do you think the name of the record came first or the photo came first? Yeah, that's the real question. Like, how douchey is it? Like, did they find the photo and go and be like, what if we called the record Trampoline, though?
I feel like they probably came up with the name first.
Yeah, probably.
They were like, ooh, what would be, like, a fun, like, one-word title?
Fun. Now let's. Like the band. Yeah. If Nate Roos comes on this episode, this will be really hilarious lead up to it.
Yeah.
I don't think we're going to get him. I don't think anyone's going to get him.
No.
But, you know, if he responds to my DM, my mysterious DM that I sent him.
He won't. Have any of you guys had Mountain Dew Voltage?
Yeah, that's what we're
drinking
tonight.
I just had it for the first time today, and it tastes like the red, white, and blue popsicles, the bomb pops.
Yeah, it's the day after Christmas, and we haven't
so
really
good.
Bought that many groceries in a minute.
These were just in my fridge.
This is just kind of all we had for mixers, but we mixed in some vodka of choice, and it's pretty good, man.
It's tasty. It tastes like a popsicle.
I mean, I kind of wanted to bring myself back to like the mid to late 2000s, when I was probably drinking a lot of Mountain Dew. You know, I thought this was sort of appropriate for the vibes tonight.
Yeah.
Mm. Oh, nice and cold in that mug. Nice
mm-hmm.
and cold.
Nice mug. Shout out to my mom.
But, you know, sonically, it's an indie pop record. Like, that's exactly how I would describe it, too. It's got big pop hooks. It's got some songs that, while you're listening to them, you think, I'm going to remember this, and then you don't.
And then you don't.
Yeah.
It's just kind of overall forgettable.
At least for me. I mean, maybe for someone, this was really their jam. But, like, I was even having trouble finding covers of songs, specifically songs mm-hmm. from this record. A couple of their hits, like Bullet, I found a lot of covers of, but not a lot off of this. Maybe someone else out there can find some, but I was having issues coming up with at least cover content. But there's still some stuff we're going to explore after this. But it was released on October 16, 2007, the record Trampoline. Looks like they went on a tour with a Person L, I think. Person L? Pearson L? It's spelled person.
Like personal?
Oh, yeah. Like oh, personal. Oh, okay, person yeah, L. Okay. Paper Revival and American Babies.
Never heard of them.
They also toured in March and April with The Starting Line, who was also on Drive Through.
Never heard of them.
And then
the only band on Drive Through Records that I'd ever heard of was Hello Goodbye, and they lost our fucking stuff for that.
Yeah, it's a real tragedy.
And
Midtown, that.
But I actually don't know any Midtown songs. If any of our listeners are listening and are mad at me about it, okay.
But to get to this this track listing here, it's. So the record is 52 minutes long. It has 12 tracks. And for me, being that close to an hour, being 12 tracks is a bit grueling. I didn't have trouble getting through it when we listened to it. I'm getting to something down here in a minute.
I was just looking at the lengths of each of the
songs. Oh, my bad. I thought it was going to spoil something. I think it's further down is what I was looking for. A lot of the songs are measuring 3-4 minutes. There's a 7-minute, a 6-minute long song in there that really, really thicken it out. I don't think there's any like weird filler stuff on like the RX Bandits record.
Yeah, it's just
it's all music. It's all songs, but
it's kind of an album that you kind of drift out of, and then you drift back in. And you're like, is this the same song? No. Yeah. It's been 20 minutes.
I mean, there were probably some more standout stuff. Like, I mean, I do think Kill Monsters in the Rain is a good song.
Yeah, that one, honestly, is really good.
I think Firecracker is pretty good, too. I think it has a good hook. I think the last song's like, kind of shitty.
Yeah, we'll get to that.
Yeah, I might have a video queued up for that. The first track is decent too. The first track really sets the mood of like it's 2007 and this is an indie pop record. Like it really feels like everything that was kind of going on around that time.
Yeah, I Feel Weird. That's a good one.
Yeah, I mean, like it has some good points to it, and I think when you drift back into the record when listening to it, like there's a reason you're coming back in because there's something cool going on. But I don't know. Like I didn't mind having it on in the background. It wasn't like offending me in any way. I didn't want to turn it off at any point necessarily, but you know, I don't know if it's something I'm going to come back to a ton.
Yeah.
But
those couple songs were really good. I would listen to those couple songs again.
But you know, Jack Antonoff also and everyone in this band kind of moved on too. So like maybe they sort of were like, yeah, this isn't really working either. Like maybe there's a reason they didn't come back to this. I don't know. Mm-hmm. What I wanted to get to though, on this record is the personnel. I think it's on song in particular. Yeah, the additional musicians on this track is Nate Roos. He does he does backing vocals on
so it's
Kill Monsters in the Rain.
Okay, well that's why that's the best one then.
Yeah, he's on the track.
The
he
one
knew.
That he's on is the standout.
He's like,
from
yeah,
this album.
This is your guys' good song. I'm gonna get on this track, and then he and Jack were like, hey, what if we did a little band together? What if we did a little band together? And they did. They made
they
a little
did.
Band together,
they
and
did.
They won
they
two Grammys.
Did.
And then they said, okay, we're done.
Yeah.
And that's the story. So, yeah, it's got Nate Roos on it. If you want to hear him, he's on this record at some point. We'll come back to him one more time before this is all said and done. But I don't know. Any other thoughts on the record before we get on to the performances? Any thoughts on this? Any more things you want to say about this band in general before we get to these videos that I've queued up? Frank,
I mean, I do want to talk about. Do you want to talk about the last song, or do you want to wait a minute to
you
talk
know,
about
I
it?
I don't. We can talk about it now. I might have a video of it coming up at some point. Women I Belong To, I think, is really is it problematic. You think?
I feel like it's problematic. Yeah, I'm gonna pull up the lyrics.
Yeah, bring up
real
the lyrics,
quick.
And if there's not much to say, maybe we'll cut it. But there might be. It definitely doesn't pass the Bechdel test.
No.
Yeah, we were listening to it earlier in a performance where they. Don't have any shoes on for some reason. I mean, some of them have shoes on, But Jack Antonoff doesn't have he doesn't have any shoes on. Is that how you say his last name? Antonoff?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I believe you. I don't know if I've ever heard anyone else say it before.
Okay. So it goes, well, I wake in the night and I want to write about what we went through. I've been lying still for weeks. Blah, 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 blah. I ain't got a dollar to my name, full of stories I am. I ramble on about love and her and her. There were two of them, one left and one died. 1 year in the life, you know I lost everything, but I found a new home in the women I belong to. They make me tired, yeah, I've seen too much. I ain't never been so alone, I never felt so cold. I swear that I want to love more than I want gold. I'd trade it all for one more story with you, or one more kiss with her, or one more year innocent. My past swings away from me as I swing beneath this old red tree. I've been swinging here for years now, and I swung through their deaths and weddings and confessed love to the women I belong to. And my mother's getting old. She watches colder winters as we age. Who does she belong to? I bet she's tired. Bet she's seen too much. I'm tired. I know I've seen too much.
So is he saying, like, he needs to get a wifey?
Pretty much.
He can't find one? He can't find the right wifey?
Can't, I guess.
No GF?
Like,
Jack have no GF?
I get, like, you know, it just seems like he's trying to be, like, outwardly feminist and woke and not succeeding at it, really, because... Like, sure, it's like, oh, you know, I love my mom and everything. But then everything else is like, these women are just what they are in relation to me.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
That's what I was really getting from it, is like...
And the title, Women I Belong To, like, it really... I don't know. It almost seems like he's trying some, like, reverse psychology shit on us, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe I'm reading into that wrong, but I don't know. Jack, if you're listening, if you're out there, get a hold of me.
You hate women so much.
Yeah, start by answering me that, and then if you don't hate women and you have a reasonable explanation for this, get a hold of me. Give me your personal cell phone number. Apparently people have no trouble just giving me their cell phone number over the internet.
Yeah. You're trustworthy. Everybody trusts someone named Toes.
Yeah. Go to my profile. That's... Just scroll through it for a bit and tell me if it seems trustworthy. Someone you trust with
you
like
got
a
no secrets.
Password
it's
to
fine.
Your credit card or something like that.
Anyway.
DM me the PIN number to your debit card, please.
But yeah, there are a lot of lyrics to that song because it's 6.5 minutes long.
Oh, fuck. That's right. Yeah. And then it ends with a bonus track called Say No to the Devil, which... Sounds like the boys are just gathered around the old microphone, singing a little tune together, show tune. Yeah, you remember that?
Yeah.
The really, very end, there's like a whole minute of silence or
something.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, right here is a
Okay, track. So yeah, it's 6.5 minutes long because it includes that last song.
Yeah, I mean, either way, that song's not very long, and like a 4 to 5 minute long song can have a lot of fucking lyrics in it.
Yeah, maybe, you know what, honestly? That bonus track might be the best
song
on the album.
Yeah, the bonus track was pretty good, actually. It might be better than Kill Monsters in the Rain.
That one does slap, though.
Yeah.
All right, let's get into your videos.
All right,
everyone. Take a little sippy.
This is,
Hammering ice.
This is where we get into the videos. All right, the first video that I found of the band Steel Train, we're going to start with a live video of the actual band. We're going to start there. We're going to kind of go... On a little journey up the hill, back down the hill, and we're going to come full circle at the end, I think, to something near and dear to all of us, for many reasons. Hopefully this doesn't sound bad.
So, I trust you. I trust you to take me on this journey.
This is the band Steel Train performing Kill Monsters in the Rain, uploaded by YouTube user Deep Rock Drive Vault. They've got... Some subscribers. This video's got like 38,000 views. I think it's just like a good live video of the band playing. I don't know if it says where they're playing. Yeah, it doesn't say where they're playing. At least not in the description of the video. Oh, no, I think this was like a televised or live stream performance of some sort, because there are screens where people are like texting in real time.
Yeah.
To the band.
Jack Antonoff, I also, this is the one where he's wearing his cute little cow sweater, but also no shoes, just socks.
This video right here that we're watching has real, like, White Stripes energy with all the red and, like, these, like, real artsy camera angles over the weird, like, organ type instrument they have. Keyboard.
Big keyboard.
I don't know. Everything just seems color coordinated, and it's got a lot of red to it. And I've watched a lot of White Stripes
red
videos
sweater, too.
from this era that kind of look like this.
He looks like a completely different person with the big hair.
Yeah, it should be stated that Jack Antonoff used to have big, like, I don't know, almost afro-y kind of hair.
Yeah, big curly hair and no glasses.
Yeah.
This one's good, though. He has a red strap, too. And that guy's got a red hat. Everything. What the fuck is going on?
They're just color coordinated. They're sweet little boys that are trying to look their best, so when their moms are watching them on TV, they can be proud.
You think their moms are proud?
If they're making this kind of music, yeah. I know my mom's not the proud of the music that I'm making, but if I was in this band, she'd be proud of me.
Nah. I don't think so.
That's fair.
Now, if you were in a if you were in like Kid Rock's backing band, then she'd be super fucking proud of you.
You think I could be in Kid Rock's backing band?
Why not?
Like just his touring band.
Yeah, sure, why not?
Yeah, dude. Touring musicians don't have to be talented. Like playing live is easy. Playing in the studio is hard.
It's all pipes
hard.
In anyway.
Yeah.
Just look good on stage.
I mean, honestly, yeah. But this is the boys just fucking rocking out to their tunes. This guy looks like this other the lead guitar player, the other guitar player. He looks like three different people to me, and I don't even know who.
He looks
like he could
very
be anyone.
Generic.
Yeah, he really could be anyone. He could play a bunch of different people in the movies, you know. Could be a stunt double. I think this song just has, like, standing power. Like, it feels like this could have came out, like, pretty recently still.
Yeah.
And, like,
I mean, it sounds like it could be a Bleachers song.
Yeah, true, yeah. Like, that's the thing about, like, indie pop is that, like, when it transcends like that, like, it really, really does. It really does, like, carry itself over the years, I think, when, I don't know, just when it comes to sounding like it's not dated. I think even, like, indie pop songs from, like, I don't know, if indie pop was a thing 30 years ago, which I guess it was, I guess it probably always has been.
Well, 30 years ago was just the 90s.
Yeah. I mean, what was an indie pop band from the 90s?
Wasn't a very long time ago.
I'm just trying to name an indie pop band from the 90s. Is that, like, I don't know. I'm sure someone out there could fucking name me one.
I was not even cognizant of the 90s.
Do the Pixies count? Or are they, like, technically a grunge band?
I would call them more grunge.
Yeah.
I don't know.
And maybe that's just the time they existed in, though.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
They have grunge aesthetic.
I guess Modest Mouse eventually leaned into indie pop, but, like, even then, they're still more strict indie at times. I don't know. They definitely leaned into it with, like, Float On and shit like that. Yeah, so, yeah, I guess it's always been around.
Was Death Cab around back then?
In the 90s? Maybe. I think early. I think, like, really, early, sorry, late.
Real late.
Late, my bad. I meant, that's what I meant. Yeah, but no, that was a good performance. I mean, they were fucking rocking out.
My dad,
sweet boys.
My dad constantly gets Modest Mouse and Fall Out Boy confused.
Hmm.
And, you know, I've sat down and talked with him. And I'm like, Dad, they sound literally nothing alike. I don't know what's wrong with you. And he's like, oh, sure they do. Like, he thinks that Fall Out Boy songs are Modest Mouse songs.
I think someone needs to have an intervention with your dad.
He needs something.
Yeah. Well, if we don't get him on our pod, maybe he'll come on this podcast one day. Maybe just like by circumstance, he'll stumble onto Zeitgeist and then they'll get him on as a guest because he becomes a big fan.
That'd be really embarrassing for me.
Yeah.
Yeah, my dad's embarrassing.
Oh. I think he'd be pretty hilarious to get an interview that he like.
I mean, honestly, he would might be pretty funny with Alex and Brian.
That's what I'm saying. I think they're between them.
Old.
Yeah, I think it'd be really funny to listen to those three have a conversation, personally.
Yeah.
Especially about a band that your dad like knows nothing about.
Yeah.
That'd be really great.
That would be pretty funny.
Okay. So I have a Tegan and Sarah video up next. They've actually covered each other's songs, it seems. So this is not a song from, I'm pretty sure this isn't a song from Trampoline, but this is a song called Turnpike, which is by Steel Train. This is a Tegan and Sarah cover because I like this band, and we're doing what I want to do tonight because we've been assigned to do this podcast, and this is what you get. But these are Canadian lesbian icons, Tegan and Sarah. Also, indie pop icons, Tegan and Sarah.
Icons in general.
Yeah, just fucking icons, man. Performing Turnpike Ghost by Steel Train.
For a long time, I didn't know that there were actually two of them.
There it is.
Thought it was just the one. Thought that it was, like, an ironic thing.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Like, I thought that there was only one of them, but they named the, like, their... thing Tegan and like and
yeah,
but there's only one of them. Then I realized that they were twins.
I don't think I've listened to this Steel Train song yet, but this just sounds like a Tegan and Sarah track to me, which I'm a fan of.
Yeah, they're good.
Yeah, this sounds like maybe something they would do. I don't know. This sounds like something before Heartthrob, but maybe like I don't know. This maybe could have been Off the Con or something like that. Sometime when they were starting to do the electronic thing, but maybe hadn't fully committed yet. Yeah, so that's pretty sick.
That was good.
If you don't know Tegan and Sarah somehow, get on that. I think Closer is a good place to start. It's their big hit, but it's a good song for a reason, man. It's a hit for a reason. So this is I think this is actually just going to be the audio of the song. This appears to be some sort of fan-made music video of the song Firecracker, which is off of Trampoline. So we're back on track. This is a... according to the description by YouTube user X I Heart Your Face, a short semi-animated music video made by Charity and Amy. Hope you like it.
Amy, A-I-M-E-E.
This comment here says, fun, arrow, the format, arrow, Steel Train, arrow, Tegan and Sarah, the order in which I found the music that I now love, and it's all I listen to now.
Okay.
I mean, hey, you got there somehow. So this is good Firecracker. This is a music video. Let's see if we can describe this while it goes by. Firecracker. So it's like, you waved in the night. So someone is filming like some paper that they've drawn pictures on. Your body. Do you think a child made this, or do you think like a teenager?
Probably like a tween.
Oh, okay. Yeah, they're kind of like going off all the lyrics in the song and like making, they've made like drawings with markers. Wow.
Wow.
The camera work is fantastic on this.
Yeah.
Legendary camera work.
God, that person that they've drawn, I love the little nose.
Yeah, with the flames in their eyes and the tears coming down.
I hope that the guys link. Make sure you save these videos.
Yeah.
Yeah. Make sure you send the links to them if they want to put them up.
Oh, okay. Well, I haven't saved any of the other ones, but I can start.
You'll be able to find them again later.
Oh, okay. I think the picture of the guy, this picture.
Yeah.
They should get that tattooed.
Yeah. Looks like
I'll get that guy.
It looks like
my
Justin Timberlake.
It does look like Justin Timberlake. Like
Instant Era, Justin Timberlake.
Let's see if we can get him in a frame. Oh, come on. Let's see if I can get... Oh.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I should get I should definitely get that tattooed.
That's really beautiful.
Wow.
Those big, luscious lips. Crying piss.
Yeah, that's... Man, that's like... That's golden era.
It's really good.
Timberlake.
Yeah.
So that was a fan-made music video that I would give 10 out of 10.
Oh, yeah. I thoroughly enjoyed it.
Probably better than... Honestly, nowadays, like, a band like Steel Train nowadays, like a semi-big indie pop band,
mm-hmm.
that's the kind of music video they would put out, but they would have spent, like, fucking 10 grand on
yeah.
it. They would have paid some asshole who probably looks like me to make.
Yeah, it's like that pup music video.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. They would have paid some money for that, huh?
Mm-hmm.
So this is
interesting that you picked that one and not the one where they had stuff written on their hands.
Oh no, I did pick that one. It's just later.
Oh.
Yeah, it's just later okay. in that video. Yeah, that is the one, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
At least that's what I was led to believe. This is Bleachers, the band Bleachers, covering Bullet by the band Steel Train.
Are you... I don't really think you have to call it a cover. You wrote both songs.
I'm also led to believe that Steel Train has the same members, because this person says in the description, does it still count as a cover if it's the same band members? But, like, I only see Jack Antonoff holding an acoustic guitar, and he looks like Travis Bickle from the movie Taxi Driver right now.
Yeah.
At this angle. Like, I don't think that... I think that's a cardigan. I don't think that's, like, an army jacket, but...
Yeah.
Like, at this exact frame at the beginning of this video, he looks like Travis Bickle from Taxi Driver.
Still wearing just the tiniest pants I've ever seen.
Oh, is he even wearing... Are those shorts? Bro.
No, those are pants.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
It looks like he's got tiny, tiny little booty shorts on and like Timberlands.
I think that's just the way the light looks.
You think so?
Yeah.
Well, this is uploaded by YouTube user Israel Dixon. Doesn't have that many views from what I saw. This is Bleachers, quote-unquote, covering Bullet by Steel Train. Bullet is off of a different Steel Train record, but this is what I could find. Someone filming a TV, or like, what's going on with the fucking light here?
I don't know, dude.
That's so strange. So yeah, it's just Jack Antonoff. Babe, he's in shorts. He's in shorts.
Oh,
look at that. You can see
no.
his.
Oh, he definitely is in pockets. Tiny little booty shorts. That's actually
that
fucking
that's
hilarious.
Underwear. I cannot tell. Wow.
He is in like a button down shirt, like collared shirt with like a big
green
sweater,
cardigan of some sort, maybe cardigan sweater,
and like boots with like crew socks and tiny, tiny little shorts,
yeah.
Like well above the knee, would not be allowed in any high school in
yeah.
North America.
Wow. All right, let's get to this.
They're not past your fingertips.
So this is the Steel Train song Bullet, which I think is like one of their big hits. Once again, not off of Trampoline. Trampoline did not have that many hits. Did not make them any money. Well, the person in the video is singing.
Yeah, that's what I was just going to say.
That wasn't me singing. So, like, did he just come out to play this song acoustically, it looks like? Because, like, I see his electric guitar over there that he plays, the red one.
Yeah, everybody else is taking a break.
Yeah. He's coming out to play his one of his old school songs that the hardcore fans know. Oh, you know, it should be stated, Jack Antonoff used to be in a hardcore band, and I forgot to mention that when we were talking about him earlier. I couldn't find it. Couldn't find his hardcore band. No, I don't remember what it's called, but if you look in his Wikipedia, it says that he used to be in some kind of hardcore band with, I think, one of the other members of Steel Train.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, the other two members were, like, two or three members were, like, in a punk band together, and mm-hmm. I couldn't find that band either. Like, I don't know. If there's any record of those bands existing, someone send them our way, because I want to hear Jack Antonoff's old hardcore band really bad.
Yeah.
I'd
love to just tear right into it.
If it's, yeah, if it's anything like Arma Angelus, I'm really fucking into it, man.
Oh, boy, oh, boy.
We've almost come full circle. So I told you I was taking you on a journey. I told everyone out there in cyberspace that I was taking you on a journey. So we're almost at the end of it. This is Steel Train covering Call It Off by Tegan and Sarah. For the Tegan and Sarah fans out there. They're doing this acoustically, which I really love when bands do acoustic performances, when the guy who sings just gets the acoustic guitar and no one else gets an instrument. They have to sit there with their arms folded and look nice. This guy looks like he's on his phone. The bassist has his bass though. But yeah, no one else was allowed to play an instrument.
These other guys are just sitting there. I think maybe this guy all the way on the left might like tap on his stool a little bit there.
Maybe.
But I think the other guys are just going to sing and maybe clap, but probably not.
Yeah. I mean, they've got a condenser mic right here and a mic there and a mic for these guys. So like, yeah, maybe we'll do some harms. Well, let's see.
I won't regret saying this thing that I'm saying.
They're in like a record store, I think. This is from 2010, the video. Uploaded by Kelly Kunk. Zia Records in Chandler. October 31st, 2010.
Halloween.
Maybe I would have been something you'd be good at. Maybe you would have been something I'd be good at.
I think he's in a costume, the bass player.
Yeah, it's Halloween.
Yeah.
Everybody else is too cool, though.
I mean, yeah.
That guy's got some ducks on his shirt.
Yeah, it's a pretty funny Halloween costume.
Guy with duck on shirt?
Yeah.
Sick. Classic.
I won't be out long, but I still think it's better if...
Yeah, these two guys all the way on the left have not done anything the entire time.
No.
See, he's got a little shaker thing that he's tapping that you can't actually hear. No, he doesn't. He was tapping on his knee. They're not doing anything.
They're all just singing along with their pal Jack. That was pretty good. That was a pretty good cover. I think Tegan and Sarah's cover of their song. I mean, it was recorded, but yeah, I think it was better. So I'm gonna bring it really full circle here. We didn't talk about the band Queen because you don't need to. However, this is a cover, or David Bowie, I guess. We didn't talk about that either. But. This is Steel Train covering the song Under Pressure by Queen and David Bowie.
In a parking lot?
Maybe. Featuring Nate Roos from the Format and Fun. Uploaded by YouTube user Jeffrey Eric Kovics. This is from January 2nd, 2010. This is actually them performing in 2009. Looks like a Christmas Eve party. Almost New Year's Eve party, my bad. 12:30:09. I had the dates wrong there. It was a standing room and people moving against me, plus it's hard to just stand there and videotape it. What do you mean? Standing room? Like, was the stage on the floor? I don't know. But this is 2 minutes and 40 seconds of them covering Under Pressure with neighbors. Probably doesn't sound too great, but is our boy.
Sweaty as hell.
Nate Roos is in a brown leather jacket. This is the most punk video I've seen all night.
Yeah. You're right.
Yeah. stage they're on. Oh, it's covered in Christmas lights.
Yeah.
Probably terrible for the sound. Probably a lot of buzzing that they've had to take care of.
Yeah, they're like on the amps and
yeah, they're touching everything. They're probably just plugged into wherever too. But this is such a small club, like
just wanted to make sure they could hear him hit those notes.
Yeah. He can hit those notes. Neighbors can hit any note.
Wow, okay.
As far as I know, I haven't seen him miss one.
Yeah, he's really hitting the D-das.
Yeah, this is fucking sick, dude.
He's so sweaty.
Man, you think people are, like, crowd-killing to this?
I hope so.
That's why the camera keeps shaking so much. People are just, like, fucking punching him in the shoulder.
Well, they said people were mashing into him.
Yeah.
Those harms.
They're best friends, these two. Best friends. Oh, man. I wish the audience could see this frame that I've landed it on.
Do you think that Jack Antonoff is bitter that he didn't get to be...
on a song with Pink?
No, Freddie Mercury in this scenario.
Hmm.
Because he was doing the... yeah.
Can I
he
ask
was doing
you,
the David Bowie
Can I actually
part.
Ask you a follow-up question to that?
You like, didn't answer my question.
Well, I
so
have.
You can't
a,
ask a fo- Okay, fine.
I have a question that might answer your okay. question though. Do you think he's actually upset that he didn't get to play Freddie Mercury in the movie, in the Bohemian Rhapsody
yes.
movie? So
yes,
I think that answers your question. I think yeah, I think he was not only upset during this performance, but then I think years later when they asked, well, first Sacha Baron Cohen and then.
Sacha Baron Cohen would have been amazing.
He would have been
way
better
than Rami Malek.
I want to see that footage. Some of
that
footage
movie was
must
a mockery
exist.
Of Freddie Mercury and if. Sacha Baron Cohen, who is he makes a mockery for a living, and
yeah,
he would have done better.
He would have.
Anyway,
what's
my hot take for this ep?
Who was it? Rami Malek? Was that who
yeah.
they got? Yeah. I didn't want to say the wrong actor.
Fake teeth.
Yeah, I think he's upset that they asked Rami Malek to play Freddie Mercury instead of him. I mean, let me just
he's
Google
like,
some
what
pictures.
Do you mean you want a person of color? I'm Jewish.
Yeah. I'm just Googling some pictures of him real quick to see how much he looks like Freddie Mercury. I'm also going to Google some pictures of Freddie Mercury in a different window. Just while I'm at it. Let's see. Good. All right, that's a good picture. That was a good big picture. Freddie... Good big picture. See, maybe this one right here. Okay, let's see.
You I know? Mean, I see it.
Yeah, kind of.
If he grew a little mustache.
Yeah, which they
got
prosthetics for that, man. They can just give him prosthetic stash.
Yeah.
Is there any pictures of him with facial hair? Nah, he's always such a clean-shaven boy.
Maybe that's why they didn't ask him. Maybe they were like, you can't grow facial
he's
hair,
too
fuck
well trimmed.
You.
He's just too well trimmed, man. You should.
He's got a little tiny bit of stubble in that one, but.
Yeah, but,
not
he's, but he's well trimmed. Okay.
Oh, wait, well,
yeah,
that,
he's got
that
a
one.
Beard in this one, but.
Okay. Pull up the picture of. Then go back. Yeah, I could see that.
Once again, they could dress this up. They could
yeah.
dress this up. They could make this work.
Yeah.
You think he's
put
a good
those
actor?
Big, stupid fake teeth on him.
You think Jack Antonoff is a good actor, maybe?
Do you think Rami Malek is a good actor?
In some movies, yeah.
Yeah, he was fantastic in Night at the Museum.
Yeah, he's a lot better in some movies, but...
No, but he is actually really good in Mr. Robot.
Oh, I haven't seen that.
I saw maybe like the first season of it, but I had to watch it illegally.
Mm.
And then I was too lazy to watch the next seasons.
Huh. So,
anyway,
what have we learned tonight about Steel Train? How do they connect to the zeitgeist of everything? Well, I mean, I think we've kind of covered that, but like we should maybe sum that up. How do they connect to the bigger picture of things? Where does Steel Train fit in?
I mean, I think they were kind of just a middleman for more popular bands.
Yeah, you think Jack Antonoff was kind of like the middle runner in a relay race?
Yeah.
Like, he's not the guy at the start, but he's not the guy getting the glory at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Man.
Right in the middle.
Yeah. He's really the He's really kind of a cuck. Like, yeah. Of the music industry.
There's nothing wrong with being a cuck.
Yeah. I mean, if you're getting paid for it, especially.
I just mean whatever makes you happy, man.
He's also probably making a lot of money.
As long as you're not hurting anybody else and everyone's consensual in that situation.
He also won those Grammys. I'm pretty sure he also won those Grammys. He's a co-writer in Fun. Like, he did a
yeah,
lot of
but...
Like, he wrote all the music.
I mean, are all of Nate Roos's Grammys for Fun?
Oh, one of them, I think, is for that Pink song.
Yeah, so get fucked.
Okay. Well, then he has
Who has
at least,
more Grammys?
That's fair. Should I...
Fuck
let
you.
Let me see. I'm going to see how many...
Also... Another hot take? That Pink song fucking sucks. I am so sick of hearing it.
You're not a fan of
it? I am so sick of it.
Okay, he has won 2 Grammys, but I'm going to see how many Grammys Nate Roos has won now.
I'm gonna find a video to show you in a minute here.
Oh, wow. So it only says that Nate Roos has one Grammy, actually. But it says Just Give Me a Reason was nominated. And it says he wrote this one. Just Give Me a Reason. Oh, featuring Nate Roos, yeah. Look at that.
Yeah, I have a video that I'd like to show you. Do you want me to put it up on there?
Yeah, what's the video?
If you just add the word kids to that.
Oh, is it a kids bop version?
No, it's just some kids doing karaoke in front of a green screen.
Oh, to this song?
Yeah.
Sweet.
This is a classic.
Hopefully this will get the copyright strike. There's sound? Hello? There it is.
No, this is just what the video's like.
Oh, okay. Wow.
This is at, like, a child's birthday party. Right from the start, you were a thief,
you stole my heart. And so there's, like, looks like 3 young girls with, like handheld fans. Like, hand fans. On one side of the green screen, fanning themselves. And, you know, 3 other kids just looking real fucking awkward on the other side. Hands in pockets.
Why do they have these stupid little paper fans?
Looks like they've done some sort of choreographed number.
Yes, yes.
Whose
I love this video.
Do you think it is? Do you think it's...
It's definitely the girl in the front on the right, I feel.
Yeah, you think it's her birthday? Ooh, see that cut?
Yeah. Yeah.
This is really good. I wish this version played on the radio. With this audio on it. I don't know. Jack Antonoff has been nominated a lot more for Grammys, though. He's been nominated in 2021 already, apparently, for a producer as non-classical.
What?
Yeah, right here. Look. 2021 producer, non-classical nominee, 2021.
For what?
When you click on this shit, it just doesn't really do anything for you. But it doesn't say.
Okay.
But next year, it says he's going to be nominated.
Producer of the
so
year.
He knows that already. Google knows that already. And this year.
What did he fucking produce?
I don't know, man. Something non-classical.
Something I mean, yeah, I guess so.
It's non-classical. Huh. Originally called the Gramophone Awards. That's pretty sick.
Oh!
But yeah,
that's
so
why
Jack
called Grammys.
Yeah.
Fuck.
So what? Our boy Jack is the bridge between all pop music.
Yeah, smack dab in the middle.
Including Queen.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, congratulations, everyone. This has been. What, do you have anything else to say before we sign off? Anything else you want to throw out there?
I don't know.
Follow us on Twitter.
I guess. No, I have to.
Yeah. If you sat through this whole experience and you thought, man, this wasn't that fun, I'd rather go listen to a My Chemical Romance podcast. Well, we have one.
We've got you covered, you little bitch.
Go listen to that and then send us money directly via Cash App or Venmo.
I don't have a Cash App.
I do.
You do?
Yeah, I don't know if I've ever used it.
What are you using that for?
I don't know. You know, I probably... My coworker paid me back for giving them money for the vending machine through Cash App. And I think maybe... I think that's how I bought a guitar. No, I think that's how Jack paid me for a guitar one time, too.
These kids.
Yeah. I think I downloaded it because I think I was going to try to buy some, like, mushrooms with it one time. And then I think it didn't end up happening. And then I just had it.
Mm-hmm.
And then just on occasion, someone's like, hey, do you have Cash App? And I'm like, yeah, actually, I do.
Cool.
Yeah. So if you have any money-sending apps that charge little to no fees for transactions.
I got PayPal. I got Venmo. I got Zelle. Not sure how to pronounce it.
Yeah, either way is fine, I think.
I got a...
So yeah, if you're a rich, wealthy investor Facebook, who wants to send us boatloads of cash for no reason.
I thought you were going to say feet pics. I will send feet pics for money. I'm desperate.
Yeah, we'll do that too. So head on over to Thanks for the Podcast on Twitter.
Thanks for the Pod. THNKSFRTHPOD.
Head on over there for all the best feet pics. And all the best takes about My Chemical Romance and updates. Remember, we're the only My Chemical Romance podcast on the internet. And I'm going to say that until it's true. Okay, good night, everyone.
Bye.
Kisses.